Welcome to this video on urea and electrolytes blood test interpretation. UNEs is essentially a blood test aimed at analysing kidney function. Its main components are urea, creatinine, estimated glomerular filtration rate, potassium, and sodium. Let's have a look at these in more detail. Urea is a waste product from metabolism of nitrogen-containing compounds in the body. It's filtered out of the blood via the kidneys and excreted in the urine. By measuring urea levels in the blood, we can see how well the kidneys are filtering it. Creatinine is another waste product from muscle and protein metabolism. It's produced by the body at a constant rate, so an increase in creatinine means it's most likely due to the kidneys not removing it effectively. eGFR is the rate at which the kidneys can filter blood, based on a calculation that uses creatinine levels, weight, and age. Acute kidney injury occurs when there's a reduced kidney function that happens over hours or days, measured by increased creatinine or reduced urine output. We can use these measurements to determine the stage of AKI, with stage 3 being the most severe. It's important to compare the current creatinine level to the patient's older levels to establish what their baseline is, and therefore help work out the stage. Causes of AKI can be split into three categories. Prerenal refers to reduced blood supply to the kidneys. This could be due to dehydration, for example in burns or reduced oral intake, from blood loss, or sepsis. In prerenal cases, we generally see a rise in urea that is proportionally greater than the rise in creatinine. Renal causes are those that damage the kidney itself. Acute tubular necrosis is irreversible damage to the nephrons caused by a prolonged prerenal AKI. Acute interstitial nephritis, which is inflammation in the kidney, is commonly caused by medications such as ACE inhibitors, NSAIDs, and antibiotics. Tubular obstruction occurs when small proteins block the nephron tubules, for example, myoglobin from rhabdomyolysis, or paraproteins in myeloma. These will generally cause a urea rise that is not proportionally as large as the creatinine rise. Postrenal refers to obstruction to urine flow. This could be caused by benign prostatic hyperplasia, renal or bladder stones, cancer, or constipation. Chronic kidney disease is reduced kidney function over a period of 3 months or more. We can determine the presence of CKD by using eGFR. The lower the eGFR, the less effective the kidneys are at filtering the blood, and therefore the higher the stage of CKD. Stage 5 is most severe and referred to as kidney failure. These patients will likely go on to require dialysis. There are many causes of CKD, but here are some common ones. Hypertension can damage the kidneys over time, as can having high blood sugar, nephrotoxic medications, heart failure, infections of the urinary system, and membranous glomerulonephritis, where the basement membrane of the glomerulus becomes damaged over time. Next, we have our electrolytes. We need to check for hyperkalemia, hypokalemia, hypernatremia, and hyponatremia. Hyperkalemia can be a medical emergency if it's raised above 6.5 or there are signs of myocardial hyperexcitability, such as chest pain, palpitations, or ECG changes. This ECG shows tall tented T waves. Other hyperkalemic ECG changes are prolonged PR intervals and widened QRS complexes. In these cases, we should start treatment with calcium gluconate, which helps stabilize the myocardium and reduces the risk of developing VT or asystole. Insulin will reduce the concentration of potassium in the blood by moving it intracellularly. And salbutamol works by a similar mechanism. We can use the mnemonic DREAD to remember the causes of hyperkalemia. This stands for DKA, renal failure, endocrine, artifact, often due to a clotted sample, and drugs, for example ACE inhibitors or potassium-sparing diuretics. Hypokalemia causes can be remembered using a different mnemonic, DIA. This stands for drugs, for example, loop or thiazide diuretics, intestinal loss, which means diarrhea and vomiting, renal tubular acidosis, and endocrine causes. For these cases, we need to replace the potassium, either orally or IV if low enough. It's important to remember, however, that we should never replace more than 20 millimoles per hour of potassium IV, as this is damaging to the blood vessels and also risks hyperkalemia. Exceptions to this would be if the patient has a central line and is in intensive care. You can remember the causes of hypernatremia using the 4 Ds: dehydration, drugs, for example, sodium-containing effervescent tablets, drips, i.e. too much IV saline, and diabetes insipidus, which is a lack of antidiuretic hormone that results in the inability to retain enough water. For hypernatremia, we also need to treat the underlying cause, as well as rehydrating with fluid either orally or IV. It's important not to use saline IV, as this can further increase sodium. Finally, hyponatremia. Causes can be split into hypovolemic, euvolemic, or hypervolemic, depending on the fluid status of the patient. For these, we again need to treat the underlying cause. We can also replace sodium or fluid restrict to increase serum sodium concentration. Here's a tip for junior doctors. Always use your local trust guidelines for managing electrolyte imbalances, as they'll give you specific cutoffs for when you should implement specific treatments. I've always found them really useful. So to summarise, we've covered the main aspects of the UNE's blood test, allowing us to assess kidney function and manage any electrolyte abnormalities. Please consider subscribing and liking the video if you found it useful. Thanks for watching, see you next time.